You're listening to Cinema Lab, a program of the Grand Rapids Community Media Center. Cinema Lab is an all-encompassing film network designed to engage our community in active viewing, appreciation, and understanding of the world of cinema. This episode of Cinema Lab is made possible by the Grand Rapids Public Library Foundation. For more information about the Grand Rapids Public Library Foundation, visit grplfoundation.org. Hello, listeners, and welcome panelists to today's episode of Cinema Lab. I'm Sarah Naraki, founder of Cinema Lab and director of Wealthy Theater. With me today, I have former WYCE station manager, local musician, and music teacher Hayes Griffin. I also have Cinema Lab co-host and Wealthy Theater's front of house manager, Caleb Dillon. And lastly, we have local musician, entrepreneur, and all-around great guy, Adrian Butler. Today, the four of us will be talking about Joseph Kuo's 1979 kung fu classic, The Mystery of Chess Boxing. This film can be streamed for free on Canopy with your Grand Rapids Public Library card. Of course, this being a movie podcast, be warned that we will be spoiling much of the movie. So if you haven't seen it yet, pause this podcast, hop over to Canopy, and then come back to us when you're ready. All right, now that the spoiler alert is out of the way, let's dive into the movie.
A game of chess is like a sword fight. You must think first, right? Before you move.
So let's start by going around the table and giving some background on, are you guys familiar with kung fu before watching this? And what did you think of the film? So Hayes, why don't we start with you?
Yeah, I was definitely familiar with kung fu before this. Mostly the kind of like, what do I want to say, the stereotypical ones that everyone's seen, like the Bruce Lee movies and Jackie Chan stuff, Drunken Master, Enter the Dragon, all that kind of stuff. This is one that had somehow slipped by me, even though I knew it's like cultural reference to Wu-Tang. Mm-hmm. So it was really interesting to kind of dive into this movie and start to draw some of those connections between the music that I had listened to and not, you know, I didn't have the background information for it.
Adrian, what about cool. you?
Yeah, so I was growing up, like my dad was into kung fu movies. And so like we would go to church on Sundays and then we'd get home and then we'd just be like in front of like random old kung fu movies. Like all, like I don't know.
Sounds beautiful.
Yeah, that's an amazing Sunday.
Yeah, yeah. So that's what we did, like me and my brother, like every Sunday for like 2 or 3 years of like my childhood life is just like kung fu. Like imagery, and I don't know what those movies were. You know what I'm saying? I have no idea. Like they were all like similar, but like all different. And
we kind of talked about that beforehand, right? There are like 900 of these things that, like, you know, it's in the in different titles change and all that kind of stuff. So it's
for
like
sure,
track
for sure, yeah. And so I think I always had like an interest in it just because it was like from a child, you know. And then like you know everybody wanted to be a ninja, and then like. You know, I think one of the things that I'm excited to talk about today is, like, why was that such a big deal at that time? You know, like, 70s and into the 80s and stuff. Like, why? I don't know. So that's, but yeah. And then, obviously, like, all the Bruce Lee movies, like you said, like, that was huge. And then the Wu-Tang, like, you know, when Wu-Tang was out, you know, back when they came out with the Wu-Tang Clan's music, especially, we started, like, me and my friends would watch, like, the movies. and smoke. So
that can be assumed behind any of this, at least on my end too. Don't worry about it.
We're talking about smoking cigarettes at the appropriate age, right?
Well, it's legal now.
Well, and Caleb, what about you? What's your background with Kung Fu?
Just as an 80s VHS kid, you know, video store kid, you couldn't avoid it. And as somebody, growing up in the early 80s, I mean, you had G.I. Joe, you had Snake Eyes, ninjas were huge, ninjas were the thing, and that's, I mean, you know, that's everybody's favorite dude. And, especially when you had a really fully stocked video store, there was no shortage of bizarrely titled, bizarrely artworked tapes. Where you just said, what is this thing? What is the Master of the Flying Guillotine? That sounds so awesome.
Amazing.
And sometimes
movie.
They were and sometimes they weren't, but it was kind of fun to take a chance on stuff like that back in the day.
Nice. Well, and this one wasn't the alt title like Ninja Checkmate or something like that too, which
Ninja Checkmate.
It's not ninjas, but
that's amazing.
That's giving Americans unlimited access to another culture's cinematography is a dangerous thing in that realm, right?
Yeah.
The specifics weren't as important back then.
Apparently. So today we're going to be talking not only about the film, but the like parallels and overlaps with the Wu-Tang Clan. But let's dive into specifically the movie first. So I want to kind of hear what you guys know about Kung Fu, like when it came to America, the specifically martial art films, I should say, not just Kung Fu in general.
Mm-hmm.
What kind of an impact did it have on our media? Do we see it represented in other movies? You know, different things like that.
I would bring up something that I found really interesting, that really the oldest film that you could probably still call a Kung Fu film came out in 1938.
Whoa.
As a two-part film, The Adventures of Fong Sai-Yuk, and no surviving copies of that exist, so you can't go and see that anywhere.
Man, why you
jerk.
Gotta tease us?
Not even on YouTube, but
who is this guy?
I just couldn't believe that it was that long ago that
38.
A so-called Kung Fu film could be identified. You know, there's a big jump between that and the early 70s emergence and popularity.
Well, and from what I understand, Kung Fu movies were banned in China in the 30s because of censorship, because of the violence, as well as superstition, because the original Kung Fu movies were more based on folklore, and they involved weapons, which you don't see in modern Kung Fu movies.
Supernatural elements.
Yeah, exactly. Mm. That kind of thing. So they said, nope, not going to do that. So what happened was these films kind of made their way to Hong Kong, which was, run by British government at that point, so they didn't have to deal with the censorship. And that's where we saw this big boom of Kung Fu movies. So in the 50s and 60s, when Hollywood was in its golden era, there was this giant boom of a similar studio system in Hong Kong.
Okay.
And I think I read that the export of Kung Fu movies surpassed what Hollywood was doing at that time, which is nuts. But you guys were talking about how there's so many of these titles. They were just cranking them out.
That would make sense, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's why exploitation films and grindhouse films from the same era were so popular, because people didn't want to wait for another Death Wish.
Mm-hmm.
If they could have six more Death Wishes that week, they were just pumped out super cheap, you know.
Yeah. So why do you guys think that Kung Fu really kind of struck a nerve with Americans in the 70s?
I don't know. I wanted to know. Can it be related to like our feelings of during the war?
I think,
you know what I'm saying?
I think that's spot on.
I mean, Sarah and I, in some of the other stuff that we talk about, every major kind of like artistic movement is usually in parallel or as a result of some kind of social or cultural movement.
Okay.
And I think you're right on. I don't know. I would assume you're right on track. That was going to be my answer.
Yeah. Well, Adrian, elaborate what you're kind of thinking.
Yeah.
Though.
I was trying to put it together in my head. You know what I mean? Like how? Like why? You know what I mean? Like, and then so I think just maybe with us like not winning the war, you know what I mean, and us like not having such a horrible experience with it.
Mm-hmm.
And that was a lot of that was televised.
The whole
it was
thing,
that the was first war to be televised.
Yeah,
with
so,
all the combat.
So then I'm thinking like, did that like create within people like an interest, you know, in some ways like in seeing that on TV all the time, create like an interest in this other culture, Asian culture. Right?
Yeah,
not Vietnam specifically, but just like, you know, because, you know, it was something that I would say like most Americans probably hadn't seen, like Asian people on their television.
Absolutely.
You know, consistently. And so did that, you know, I don't know. That was kind of like where I was, what I was thinking, but you know, I'm not a scholar like you are.
So well, yeah, you are.
But I think we can all establish right now we are all just four people sitting around a table talking about this thing, right? You know.
Right.
But I would say that you're onto something that at least rings true in my mind, knowing a little bit about the history of the Vietnam War, and specifically with just like how it relates to music. You know, you see like more, what do I want to say? Like heavy metal was born in this era that we're talking about. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? The like what we would call heavy metal music right now, and that involves like a lot of it's testosterone fueled, it's high energy. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
And just mirroring the violence that you're seeing on the news
every day, right? And I think that like what Adrian is saying about Kung Fu movies in the way that they're received in America at this time may be the same reason that you see a lot of kids donning black and jeans and listening to heavy metal or punk music or even hip hop, right? Because hip hop was born right in this time as well. So
yeah, late 70s for sure.
Yeah, right. And I mean, like Kool Herc was like doing his thing in the early 70s at this point in time. So like there are the seeds of these things starting to bubble up in culture, and I think Kung Fu might be a similar kind of phenomenon to the musical side of things. I don't know.
I think you're right. And something I wanted to go back with what Adrian said of we're reflecting on the fact that we didn't win this war and honestly shouldn't have been part of it in the first place.
Look, let's not get political here, Sarah. Okay.
I'll pump the brakes on that. All right. But yeah, the idea that you can then live vicariously through this film or through any film, through any story, and, you know, be there with the main character, the protagonist, who's heroic and winning and like seeks the revenge and actually succeeds with it. So I think that's pretty accurate. I think you're spot on. So I'd say you're a scholar, Adrian.
he's just a humble one, right? Yeah.
Yeah, there's no way to underestimate the effect of marginalized groups of people seeing people that might look like them or at least not look like the enemy actually winning on screen and actually, you know, being seen as the hero for maybe the first time in their life.
Yeah, definitely. And then even continuing on with the film discussion, so Kung Fu movies made their way to America in the 70s. Mm-hmm. What other kind of ripple effect do we see? Like, where are we seeing Kung Fu mimicked in other movies?
So I feel like everything that whenever I watch, like, those movies from the 70s, like, they all, like, kind of have, like, this, like, that camera thing. Where the zoom it kind of like sweeps or I don't know
that's so hilarious that you would say that because like I always get into this conversation with like Sarah, I'm an idiot when it comes to like film terms, you know what I mean? But I was thinking in my mind the exact same thing that like super sharp like zoom in on the character who just did like, you know, some kind of like intense move, right?
You
know,
but it's like, using the right language, don't worry. We're talking a zoom
and it's always
switch
it's
pan.
Never it's, yeah. it's always like off. Like it's off center. It's never
like when
it's
they
never
punch
like,
in.
Yes,
it's not framed right. I love it.
I love that. Like that's like one of my favorite things of all time. Like,
yeah,
the terrible filmmaking is why you love the movie.
Well, but like I mean, he's saying that he sees Adrian's saying that he sees this in other films. Like my dad, I grew up watching some kung fu movies, but it was also splashed in with these like post-Vietnam kind of American war films, like you're talking Rambo, Missing in Action, all those kinds of like, you know, like American martial arts films. And like, we're talking Chuck Norris at this point, right? Like, he totally, like, he has the Kung Fu playbook.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
That's
that's what he does, right?
Oh, for sure.
So you see it in those kinds of films. I do, at least, you know? And then, like Caleb said, freaking G.I. Joe. It makes its way into, like, cartoons and all this stuff, too, you know?
Yeah, Rambo. Rambo could easily... That's a kung fu movie. You know what I'm saying? Like, you just change the setting, and it's like, that plot is like...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Only we inserted our own, like, white savior into the middle of it instead of, like,
we
some...
We never do that.
Yeah, instead of, like, some, you know, like, guy from Hong Kong.
Right.
But, yeah, it seems like... It does seem like that... I don't know. Did films get more violent in the 70s too?
Absolutely.
Obviously, right? Like,
yeah.
And that might be, I mean, kung fu movies, you know, that
they're pretty violent.
The ketchup blood or whatever it is.
Too much. I can't take it.
I love it so much.
Yeah, I mean, after the Vietnam War, that's when we saw slasher films really come out, and horror really had a big uptick because we're seeing the violence on TV. And so maybe it's cathartic, maybe it's like desensitized from TV, but we start to see that in movies. And we saw similar patterns even with, you know, after 2000, 2001, when we're talking about terrorism and there's some pretty graphic videos surfacing on the internet. Well, then we have the era of, like, gore porn, for lack of a better term, that came out early 2000s, like Saw, Hostel, all those series. So, absolutely, you have that tidal wave impact from what's going on in the real world to how it's showing up in movies. I want to throw it to Caleb. Any other input on where we're seeing kung fu and martial arts in modern American films?
Well, I mean, once the era of kung fu crossed over into the mainstream of America, I mean, obviously leading up to something like The Matrix in 99, I was trying to think of what action-oriented, fighting-oriented movies that have come out in the last 20 years didn't employ mostly martial arts.
So
and
true.
Honestly, I'm not thinking of...
That's a great point.
I was even thinking about when Daniel Craig's Bond came out, and one of the opening scenes of the first movie where he's employing all these different martial arts styles and parkour and all these crazy things, and people were like, oh, wow, this is a new Bond. This is cool, you know? But it's like, what non-martial arts action movies are we seeing?
Right.
Like, those would seem out of place or unusual.
Yeah.
If they didn't incorporate that, so.
Yeah, if you're a secret agent or...
You know kung fu.
Yeah, it's just part
right.
of
Among
part
many
of
others.
You.
Yeah.
But no, that's an awesome point, because I was just thinking, the only thing that I can... The Bourne movies were like that, like, really dirty, like, crazy, like fighting, like, just... Mm-hmm. I remember that being like, oh, that doesn't feel like... what I am used to as kung fu.
Sure.
And that's the only thing that I can think of. But, like, even that's influenced. The fact that it has to do so much to, like, not be kung fu, it's kind of influenced by kung fu. Anyways,
right.
You know?
Well, and even some of the choreography of the fight sequences, I think we can say, is an homage to original
that's
martial
true.
Arts.
Once those choreographers started to work, especially from Hong Kong in American movies, we never went back from that.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, just look at, like, Tomb Raider versus, like, you know, Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon, and then any of the stuff before it. You know what I mean? It's all this, like, florid kind of flying around stuff, right? Like, they came into their own after the...
Well, because you think pre-70s, you think 50s and 60s, if you had an action movie, it was a war movie, which didn't employ any martial arts, or it was maybe a boxing movie, but it was just straight traditional boxing.
It wasn't chess boxing.
No.
Yeah.
Well, but even you guys were talking about the James Bond series, and that started in the 60s, right? Was it like 63 or something? I think was the first one. Well, and kung fu movies were starting to show up around that time, right? Mm-hmm. So you have that influence. I know, right? Mind blown. This is why I like doing podcasts.
This is crazy. Oh, Sarah's great.
Yeah.
She's great. You guys are great. Yeah, because the... No disrespect to Sean and his work, but I get bored watching some of the early James Bond movies.
Yeah.
And so now, to your point, like after Kung Fu comes out as a thing, the action is definitely like, you know.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah.
No, that's interesting. I never even thought about that. Yeah, like thinking like 60s Bond films versus the ones that come out in the 70s, you know,
right.
What I mean? There's a difference there. I'm even like starting to collate inside my mind, you know?
Well, and I feel like I'm probably not alone in feeling this from specifically the Mystery of Chess Boxing, but the main character, Ah Pao, hopefully I'm saying his name right, made me think of Luke Skywalker, like 100%. And I know, well, yeah, I guess that...
That makes
it wasn't before that, but, you know, he's not an uncommon character. And I feel like Star Wars, no doubt, kind of pulled from this concept. And not that Kung Fu movies started the hero's journey. I mean, that's just been part of literature forever. But they focus in on the revenge aspect, the mentorship, this journey,
yeah.
right? This, like, internal, you know, mental and physical journey. And you certainly see that in Star Wars. So I feel like it's the same thing.
Think about Yoda's training regimen for Luke versus
right.
what Ah Pao went through in
like the kitchen scene. Totally. Yeah. I'm like, this is Yoda.
Yeah.
Well, and just because this particular movie came out in 79 doesn't mean that you'd see some of the exact same tropes and character arcs in something earlier 70s.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's another thing, just the storytelling with the Kung Fu movies. There's not, I mean, I haven't seen all of them. I'm fairly new to Kung Fu films.
No one's seen all of them.
Yeah, hopefully not. Well, no, you say that. There's one person in the world who's probably seen them all.
Yeah, excuse me, Caleb.
But, you know, with this one, this was a fairly popular one. The storyline is not entirely existent, or it's really choppy, and it still works. You know, you don't have this fluid narrative. You do have a goal of revenge, and we get through that, but it's not the normal, like, Hollywood narrative that we're used to, where everything is cohesive and it flows together.
Like, let's get to the fighting, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, yeah, for audiences at the time, especially, like I said, exploitation and kind of grindhouse audiences, they weren't going for a perfectly crafted story.
Mm-hmm.
They wanted to hang out with their friends and watch some fighting and
see some backflips,
see
right?
some weird stuff and, you know, some crazy names and, you know, hoot and holler.
Right. Yeah. I was so into it. I had no idea what I was getting into. And when I played it and it started, I'm like, oh, yeah, all right, here we go. But the intro sequence for this film, too, I love it so much. But I think I especially love it because it made me think of the intro for Do the Right Thing.
Oh.
I don't know if it influenced that, but it definitely made me think of that. And I think Do the Right Thing, it felt more like a theatrical, like a stage production, and it felt like that kind of intro, but it seemed similar to that. Like, this is just so cool. I love it.
That's cool.
Let's talk about the history of hip-hop. I think that'll kind of ease us into it. So
yeah.
Hip-hop, Hayes, you were getting into it a little earlier about hip-hop kind of coming to the forefront around the 70s. Maybe give us some kind of backstory on that.
As I understand it, for those of you out there who are listening, by the way, don't listen to me. Go watch Hip Hop Evolution on Netflix. Watch the entire series four times over. It's got
that's
everything
amazing,
in there that
yeah.
you need to know, right? Hip hop grew out of the Bronx in the early 70s. Like, at this point in time, the Bronx was burning, literally, in New York. Like, it was... I forget what the percentage was, but it was something like near half or over half the buildings there were condemned.
Yeah.
You know, like
crazy.
People were just living in squalor in the entire place. And like we said earlier, you know, every dire social movement in history always has some sort of like artistic expression that goes along with it, right?
Mm-hmm.
And if you're thinking about the Bronx, like, this is why, in my opinion, hip-hop is one of the most beautiful American art forms to exist ever. You've got people who don't have two nickels to rub together, and they create music out of other people's music with the equipment that they have available to them. Like, you listen to their stories, they're dumpster diving, they're finding old amplifiers, stereo receivers, turntables, you know what I mean? Their parents have record collections, and, you know, it's people like Kool Herc, Grandmaster Flash, they get these ideas to like start taking snippets of the music that they already listen to and, you know, use two turntables to kind of hit the break they call it, right? Like the like a really solid drum section in the middle of typically some like soul tune or funk tune or, you know, Afro-Cuban kind of drum beat tune. So, hip-hop comes out of the Bronx in the 70s out of this kind of like really dire social movement that happens, you know, and you see it grow in that area and expand outward through the 1980s. And it hits every borough after that, right? Like it starts in the Bronx, but then every borough in New York kind of has its own take and flavor that it adds to the hip hop realm. And I mean, there's a lot of history that I'm skipping in the middle here, but if we get to the late 80s, early 90s, then we're talking Staten Island and Wu-Tang, right? Like they've had Afrika Bambaataa and all these guys to kind of like build off of until that point in time, you know?
Yeah, that's a good point. There's the Wu-Tang, one of the Wu-Tang documentaries, I think it's the Showtime one.
Uh-huh.
The one that's on Showtime. That was one thing that I was like, whoa, what? So, you know, because they grew up in the birthplace of, you know, they grew up there.
Yeah.
So like Ghostface Killah was a breakdancer. And I'm like, what? Him? there's a photo of like him, like, you know,
and his B-boy outfit. Yeah.
I was like, that's crazy. That's so crazy. So like, and you know, so a lot of the early hip hop groups were groups. You know what I mean? It was like,
exactly.
It was like a crew. It was like, you know, multiple rappers. And so that makes perfect sense that like Wu-Tang, you know, would adopt that same sort of like format for their group and stuff
too. Yeah, I mean, like the Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five were kind of like the like first popular instance of that, right? And I feel like a lot of folks followed in their footsteps, especially after the Blackout Riots.
Yeah,
when they, you know, I love that in the Hip Hop Evolution series they talk about the Blackout Riots being the time where everyone was able to accrue all the gear to kind of finally like put their crew together and have their own thing, you know. I think that's beautiful. I'm sorry. that's great.
Well, and getting into the concept of it being an ensemble of people, not just like a traditional band that we're used to of guitar, bass, drums, whatever. It's still an ensemble. And, you know, they're talking about they have the 9 members and each one is bringing something different to the table. And I think RZA was the one, maybe it was in Tao of Wu, was talking about kind of some parallels with that and the 5 elements of Kung Fu.
Yeah.
I warn you, you have no chance. You recognize this technique?
Huh? 5 elements.
You remember.
And how they're all sort of like their own elements coming together in the same way that the Kung Fu elements work together. And with Kung Fu and martial arts, which, you know, I did like karate or taekwondo or something when I was a kid, but I don't really know much about it. But, you know, RZA was getting into how you have the 5 elements like earth, water, metal, wood, fire, and then each of those parallels to the different animals like snake, crane, dragon, leopard, and tiger. But then even beyond that, the elements are tied to the 5 points, like 5 major organs in the body. And he was saying, you know, he's got asthma, so he learned to work with, like, the element that would represent the lung, which I believe was metal. And, you know, just kind of, like, overlapping these things, and it made me think of, like, chakras, and, you know, there's so many...
Yeah, circles upon circles kind of thing,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, absolutely. But to think of Wu-Tang as this, like, beautifully orchestrated ensemble of not just, I'm going to stand out, and this is the thing that I'm really good at, like... This is maybe not the best example. Like, if you think Destiny's Child and then Beyonce, right? Mm-hmm. Like, she stands out as her own thing, does her own thing. But Wu-Tang is just, like, beautifully orchestrated, and there are all these different elements that work well together but can be separate, too.
Mm-hmm.
Well, yeah, you see that in a lot of the Kung Fu films where there's a group or a clan, and, you know, there's not one person that's more important than the other. They've got to take on some big bad guy at the end.
Mm.
They've all got their own fighting styles.
Yeah.
They've all got their own specific rap delivery, and they've all got to work together to defeat whatever this common enemy is.
Yeah, that's good.
Mm-hmm. And I think even just the concept of Kung Fu being about, like, love and family and loyalty and, you know, just good morals, and that the Wu-Tang Clan, they're about like sticking together like a family. They are a clan.
Yeah.
They're helping each other out and helping their community too, I think is really amazing. Great takeaway.
Even the chess master in the movie, you know what I mean? He talks about Kung Fu as it's a mental practice. And in the documentary that was on Canopy, did either of you folks, any of you folks check that one out?
Mm-hmm.
I forget, was it RZA that was talking about the kind of connection there? Like, what Wu-Tang is about is like like the reason that they adopted Wu-Tang is because it's a sword style, right? And they're like they use their tongues as swords to cut through their enemies and stuff like that. So that, like, it's extremely deep and well thought out, and kind of like they are practicing a martial art. You know, the term Kung Fu, I don't know if you found this out in your kind of like studies on it, it doesn't mean like the fighting style that
it's pretty broad.
Yeah, it just means like any kind of mental practice that requires like years of study to hone your craft. So like, I would argue that Wu-Tang are actually like Kung Fu masters, you know what I mean? In that sense, because they've, I mean, you listen to Ghostface Killah's rhyme schemes or any of them really, you know what I mean? Like it's extremely deep and complex in ways that you can't comprehend immediately on the surface.
Yeah, it's definitely more about discipline and skill than it is specifically just fighting.
Yeah,
you know, it's about mastery over something.
Agreed.
I want to bring it to more of a local level, and Adrian, I want to get your input on, like, what does hip hop mean to you? I know you have a background with rapping and hip hop and part of the scene, and can you give us some insight? Do you feel that there's parallels between like the West Michigan hip hop scene and what Hayes was into with the East Coast?
So, yes, for sure. I think, when was this? This was 92 or 93. I remember getting, my cousin had a Wu-Tang cassette tape. And he was like my older cousin. Like, he lived on Bates. Around the corner. So, but anyway, like, he gave me this tape. He showed me the tape. He's like, this is the shit. Like, this is, you need to listen to this. You know what I mean?
I'ma give it to you with no trivia. Roll like cocaine straight from Bolivia. My hip hop will rock and shock the nation like the Emancipation Proclamation. Weak MCs approach with slang that's dead. Them eyes are running to the wall and bang your head. I push a force, my force you're doubting. I'm making devils cower to the Caucasus Mountains.
When I'm Messiah, I set the microphone on fire. Rap styles Barry and carry like Mariah.
What is Wu-Tang? Like, what is this? You know what I mean? I was like, it was the summer before ninth grade for me. So then I get to Ottawa Hills High School is where I went to high school. And then, like, every once in a while, you'd see, like, a Wu-Tang sticker, like, on a locker or, like, on a pole, like, on the way to school or something. You know, like, it was, like, this, like, secret thing. I'm like, oh, that's the tape that my cousin had. Like, now it's, like, what is this? Like, other people know about this, too. Like, what you know what I mean? It was, like, a mysterious, like, sort of, like, underground thing is what it, like, felt like. And so then, you know, you learn about it, and you find out, like, what the music is. And then you're like, oh, that's the other thing. The first video I saw was Mystery of Chess Boxing.
Yeah.
And it's crazy. It's like a great video, but like Ghostface Killah, like you're like, who's that? you don't even see his face. Oh my, you like, you know, and you know, before that, you're used to like rappers like being in your face and like, you know what I'm saying, like it being more about the rapper, and for some reason that felt like it was more about something deeper and something like more mysterious that you needed to like learn and like dive into. But then at the same time, it was really like rugged and like really, really like raw, you know what I mean? And so, man, like I think everybody wanted to sound like Wu-Tang, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know, all the cyphers in high school, you know, everybody was like everybody pulled their rap names or their styles definitely were influenced by Wu-Tang. You had like a crew called like the Nappy Head Assassins, and like so assassin was like, you know, like that's a Wu-Tang terminology, you know what I mean? Like you had like an amazing rapper named Tai Chi, you know what I mean? So like, you know, like just like obvious things in obvious ways that, oh, but everybody was wearing like Wallabies, you know what I'm saying? Like that was like you know what I mean? Like so in Grand Rapids, you know, if mid 90s through the end of the 90s, I mean, yeah, that's like everybody was like, Wu-Tang was just like everything. So even you know, you can, I'm sure you'll run into certain people now that like sound like they are from New York, and you're like, are you? But you're not from New York, but like you sound like you're from New York. You like, you just say like people, if you listen to Wu-Tang long enough, I guess, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You know, and you that's, you know, that's the persona that you kind of want to like take on, you know what I mean? So it was influential in so many ways. But I would say like for sure everyone trying to rap like some member of Wu-Tang, you know what I'm saying? And so vocabulary was like really important. Just even like the style and cadence of delivery, and it's just funny to listen to rappers or to rap that was out in Grand Rapids during that time. It just sounds like it could just be like pulled from New York, or they could be like that's like the opening band for Wu-Tang. You know what I'm saying? If you like Wu-Tang, you might like this. You know,
yeah, your Spotify suggestions, yeah, or whatever, right?
Yeah, it's crazy. So that was. That was the thing too. Like there was always like the argument and the discussion of like who's your favorite member of the Wu-Tang Clan and like what, you know what I mean? And you hear rappers and you're like immediately like, oh, like you sound like GZA, or you sound like Ghost, or you're trying to sound like you're trying to sound like this, you know what I mean? So it was the influence was heavy. I mean it was everywhere. Like from style to just everything. And as what was interesting is as Wu-Tang evolved, you know what I'm saying, like everybody followed, you know what I mean? So like when like the Wu, when they did like the whole Wu Gambino thing, like you know, Raekwon's album and stuff, and they kind of like started to involve like the mafioso sort of ideas, you know what I mean? That was something that everybody attached to as well, you know what I'm saying? So it's, yeah. Just, yeah, they were, it was amazing.
Yeah, I feel like with that kind of stuff, it's easy to look back now, or maybe someone younger would look at that and go, oh, they were following the trend of, you know, that thing. It's like, no, they started the trend.
Yeah.
They were the reason everybody was doing that.
Yeah.
That's really interesting. And I almost feel like from watching some of the, like, documentaries that Sarah suggested to us, you know, that like kind of like where Wu-Tang talks about their history with this music, that you fell right into the trap that they laid for you, right? Because they talk about this kind of like the reason that they loved Kung Fu culture was that it was underground, it was hard to access, and then you're talking about like running around high school and you're like, oh my God, there's a Wu-Tang sticker, you know what I mean? Like it's like Ghostface Killer from the movie, you know what I mean? Like throwing his medallions out there, like, yeah. You see the medallion, you're like, oh my God, it's Ghostface Killer, you know? Like, so like, I don't know, like drawing those connections, that's like awesome to me that you were able to interact with it in that way.
Well, and even the piggybacking off of that, that it kind of parallels to that concept of the Shaolin, like the place of study that you have to find. It's not just, oh, here, sign up for this university, you know, and yeah. In this movie, he seeks it out, kind of sneaks into it in his weird way. So it feels like that too, like these signs of, you know, come join Wu-Tang, learn about it, you know, this place of learning, you know what I mean?
Yep.
The thing with the medallion and Ghostface Killer throwing it down, it made me think a little bit of like breakdancing dance offs, and sometimes people like draw a line with their foot, like, all right, you know, challenge is yours. It kind of made me think of that he's like running around throwing the medallion, like, all right, let's fight, you know.
Yeah, I was gonna say, I mean, hip hop is evolving and reaching more and more people in the early 70s at the exact same time that breakdancing is. And if you look at the improvised acrobatics of breakdancing, what's the difference between that and Kung Fu, except they're just not actually hitting each other?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, everybody's got their own style, and there's crews working together.
No,
it's interchangeable.
That's interesting. It's like capoeira, that like Brazilian style of fight dancing. You know, it's,
do you
it's
only like, know that from Bob's Burgers, by the way?
I do not. No, I do not only know that from Bob's Burgers. We had a capoeira artist in residence when I was in college.
Oh,
no?
Well, of course.
No, yeah, seriously.
Oh, that's great.
But it's like, it's kind of the same thing, right?
Mm-hmm. No, that's a good point about the breakdancing.
Well, and I mean, well, I guess even like too. Rap I mean, battles too, right? You know, all that stuff.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Now that they like kung fu fighting, right? Like that was Village People, like so, like it just definitely like influenced like everything, mm-hmm. like these kung fu movies, like across, like from
yeah, know, it was a pop tune, right?
The, yeah.
Yep.
And speaking of the dancing choreography with kung fu. At first when I was watching this film, I'm like, man, it's so corny that you can see that they're not hitting each other. And I just thought that was really ridiculous. Like, it, you know, it's such a cliche for bad movies, like throwing a punch and then cut to somebody like getting tossed away.
Yeah.
But I started to appreciate it because then you focus more on the choreography and the intricacy of the fight.
Mm.
And especially when they're like, you know, bending backwards, like doing the almost like a bridge kind of pose. And then hovering there, very much like the Matrix, and bending backwards when the bullets are coming at them.
Yeah, except they're really doing that
in a lot of cases.
You look at it,
amazing.
And you're used to the quick cut, you know, editing style of today, and you're like, well, this is all. And you're like, well, no, this shot has been unbroken for like 5 seconds.
Right.
Like, they're actually flipping around and doing all that stuff.
Yep.
Yeah.
And isn't it more difficult to do all those moves and not actually hit the guy?
That's what I mean. And then when we get...
I can't do that. If we were kung fu
like
fighting right now...
Right.
Get close enough.
We both get messed up.
Right. Well, and then not just in like the violent fighting way, but even in the sequence in the kitchen when the cook is like, you know, if you can steal this rice from me, then you can have it. And just how he's quickly flipping it around, it's like the same thing. Like that felt as exciting as the fighting sequences, mm-hmm. just because it's so beautifully orchestrated. Mm-hmm. So even though the films are like pretty corny and the sound effects, oh man, should we get into the sound effects? Like
that's the thing that I immediately noticed when I started watching kung fu films. It's like none of the punching actually lines up with the sound effects, and it's just like it's like two boards clapping together whenever they hit one another, you know. Like,
oh my god, it made me think of Always Sunny, you know, Mac's character. He's like like that.
Exactly. I wanted to, do you know anything about the Foley for this, like what sounds did they specifically use for the punching and stuff?
Because
like
the punching in these movies does not sound like any other era of anything.
I guess you thought that you'd escape. But I shall get all of you.
But why
the only thing I can draw it to, like Motown records for the claps, a lot of times they would literally just have two 2x4s that they were smacking together.
Oh, they'd use chains, they'd use whatever.
And some of that stuff sounds similar to me, so I just didn't know if it was anything like that, you know?
Yeah, it was probably just punching sandbags and stuff. Like now with Foleying punches, they'll punch like, you know, a ham hock or something that's got like a flesh kind of you know, feel to it instead of actually hitting a person. But it seemed really fake and it didn't seem like a natural sound for that. But
I actually thought that a lot of the hits sounded like some of the real gritty kind of lo-fi produced beats on the early Wu-Tang stuff. I mean, I could almost see them sampling some of
cool.
those punches and kicks and be like, all right, well, there's our beat right there, because it's so
I know that they sampled dialogue from the films. It probably wouldn't be a far stretch to think that they took some of that stuff right. That's
at least in just what sounded good to them, because they were used to watching so many of these movies. It's like, as opposed to a really polished sounding drum machine or something, it's like that's why that music sounds so dark and weird. And it kind of, I mean, the sound of their early music to me kind of mirrored the poor quality of some bootleg version of something that they're probably watching on TV as kids.
That's so true, man. Like, yeah, it did. The quality of their recordings definitely was like lo-fi and like had.
I mean, just because of the limitations of their budget,
but
I think
it worked though,
right?
Like it made it better. Yeah. For some reason, you know what I mean?
Especially, if it was perfect and polished, well, yeah, we wouldn't get that anywhere.
Because I think that added to the appeal too, because like it wasn't like radio worthy right. mixing. You know what I'm saying? Like it wasn't done for that purpose. It was like, that's.
Well, it's almost like folkloric in some way, right? Like you're talking about, you say it was it your cousin that gave you the tape? Yeah. It's like this like weird archival thing handed down to you. You have no clue where it came from. It's a little gritty, rough around the edges, you know, mm-hmm. but it's got all this like wisdom packed into it. There's like that parallels the like hero's journey in the Kung Fu movies in a lot of ways mm-hmm. too. You know, the way that that music was passed to you and the quality that it has.
And the way that they used the way they sampled the vocals and the dialogue and how they would like sometimes throw like slightly different music underneath mm-hmm. some of those like vocal samples. It made it like, usually you're watching a Kung Fu movie, like just watching the movie and then you're just like, oh, like, you know, this is dubbed and like, it's kind of like, you know, you killed my brother, blah, blah, blah. You know, like this is kind of like, it's kind of corny, you know what I mean? But then like all of a sudden, like in the context of like Wu-Tang music used as like an interlude, it all of a sudden became like heavy and deep, and you were like, "Whoa!"
This
like,
sounds this way more dramatic than it actually was in the movie. They definitely knew how to pick good quotes out of those.
The intro to the mystery of chess boxing, you know what I mean? They rip that dialogue right out of there, and it's like it carries this weight and sets you up for the rest of the tune.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah,
that's awesome.
And bringing it back to the movie too, we're talking about, you know, the dialogue and the dubbing being kind of comical. I think too, the other thing was, aside from the fighting, there was just something else to the movie that felt really like physical comedy, and it was such a nod to like the silent era.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't know if I was supposed to laugh at first until we got to some of the stuff like the kitchen scene and that kind of thing. I'm like, okay, yeah, some of this is supposed to be funny. And I thought it was a great homage to the dawn of cinema and what had to be done in like a translation from vaudeville theater on screen and just using your body and not having to rely on, you know, whether it's a soundtrack or dialogue. You could certainly watch Kung Fu movies with the sound off and almost enjoy it as much, except I think I'd miss those punching sounds.
Yeah.
And when I was reading about it, like they were saying Jackie Chan was the Buster Keaton of Kung Fu.
Yeah.
And obviously, with Jackie Chan, Bruce Lee, like doing your own stunts, sure, there's that. But then you also have like the physical comedy element of it too. And just that those guys knew they had to kind of lean into that.
And I don't know a lot about the history of it, but I know that a lot of that comes straight from like traditional Chinese theater. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? The kind that's existed for like thousands of years. That mm-hmm. kind of like, what do I want to say? Like hyperbolic, caricature-esque depiction of, you know, comedy and whatnot. Okay. Like I said, I don't know much about the history of that, but I know that that thread comes from that too, you know?
Well, I think easily it's a parallel with what we know with American vaudeville theater and how that translated on screen with movies. It makes sense that it would be very similar.
Yeah.
And you can see that in the movie, even with the costuming, like the guy's like super intense eyebrows.
And they put those eyebrows, like, my wife and I were talking about this Ghostface Killer. The fact that they try to make him look older with all those eyebrows and stuff almost makes him look like more of a baby. You know what I mean? It's like, are you like 12? You know, like.
It was a precursor to Benjamin Button is what it was.
That's funny.
But I don't know the character's name that has like the white wig on that he's fighting, like the second person that he fights. You know, when he's flipping around, you can see the black hair underneath it. And again, it was making me think of Always Sunny with Frank's character when he's like doing the art dealing. And he's like, that's derivative.
Yeah.
like that wig.
That's funny, because even, Pai Mei.
Oh, of course.
That's why I like that movie better than the I like the second one better than the first one, because of the Pai Mei mm-hmm. training. And that reminds me of, like, it's just crazy, like, how it's, like, just, like, embedded in everything we, you know what I mean?
you could pick it apart for endlessly.
It's kind of like how celebrate.
It's weirdness.
You know? It's like how all these movies, you know, movies like, they're like, oh, we need like a really bad villain. They gotta be like really evil. Oh, he's a Nazi actually. Like it's like it's like how that is like always present, like as like a thing. You know what I'm saying? Like all the kung fu stuff is like always here with us now. Mm-hmm. I'm not mad about it. I love it.
Yeah. Just noticing, right?
Yeah,
I love it.
So, what do you guys think is kind of the purpose of kung fu movies? I mean, is there a lesson that we always learn in it? Is it solely for entertainment, just like on a superficial level? What do you guys think?
That's great.
I mean, I think like we were talking about just the meaning of kung fu in the first place. It's about encouraging, you know, a mastery over a skill or a discipline or, you know, whatever it is, your physical fitness or mental focus or something like that. And because, you know, almost all of the films have something in common, which is either one person or a group of people that have to defeat some enemy. But it's almost always for the greater good of, you know, a city or a village or, you know, for revenge, but for, I don't know, like the good kind of revenge.
Retribution.
Yeah. No, you're right. Like it's not just like personal.
Right.
It's it is personal, but you carrying out this mission impacts like all these other. That's a good point. So yeah, and then you'll probably have to die for what you believe in.
Yeah. Which happens, right? You know, like usually it's never the main guy that dies, but like the how many times has the like, because we talk about the hero's journey in these films, how many times does the like it get to the end of the film and his master is fighting the enemy and then the master dies and he like avenges him at the last minute? You know what I mean? Like the, you see these threads throughout the whole thing. So I think it's.
I think the need to confront like evil is like definitely like a theme that I take from kung fu movies, you know what I mean? And I think that's like, you know, really applicable to like everything out here in life is just that, you know,
I like how you said the need to confront evil, you know, like not just confronting evil, but the fact that you have to, right?
Yeah. Otherwise, because I mean, you see what they did, you know. Harry Potter could have been like 3 movies, you know. Could have been 3 books. If they would have handled that.
Don't even get me started, man.
I'm with you. I like this.
Get out of here. Give me more.
I like this.
Oh my god.
Adrian, I didn't meet you before today, but we're gonna be friends, man. This is
it's 3-on-1, unfortunately.
I love the Harry Potter movies.
Sure.
Oh, do you?
I mean, I'm not as much as you. I know that you are on another level. I'm recognizing
level.
Where I am, but I do love those movies for sure.
Yeah.
They could have been edited down. I mean, those things are like 4 inches thick. So.
I'm just saying, like in general, like you know that there's this evil out here.
Mm-hmm.
Like go handle it before it grows and becomes. Right. Yeah. You know. That's all, yeah.
It doesn't need to get to the 7th book, is what he's saying. It doesn't need to get to the 7th book, you know? It might, but...
I'll say it does.
I know this is off topic, but I love Star Wars as well. But after watching the most recent installment in the main Star Wars movie canon or whatever, you know, it dawned on me that like I like Harry Potter as a series, as a story, you know, far more than I like Star Wars, and it was really hard for me to come to that conclusion in my head.
Whoa.
I'm teasing the next podcast.
Right.
I would like to be a
tune
part
in
of that
next
podcast.
Time. Harry Potter versus Star Wars.
Well, I'm just saying, like, there were some things in this last movie that I was just like, I just can't deal with this. And I just felt like, I don't know, man. Should have had JJ for all 3. And I just have strong feelings about that. So anyway, long story short, I was realizing that, I think Harry Potter is a better overall story. to me.
It makes you yearn for the simplicity of the mystery of chess boxing.
You know? But truly, like, I think you certainly can drag a story out, whether it's Harry Potter or Star Wars or The Matrix or anything, or, you know, we talked about the Bourne series. And maybe that's just more for cashing in on it. But I do like that you can isolate these stories and just have it more episodic with each of these kung fu films.
An hour and 26 minutes, you're in, you're out.
Right.
You get the full arc, right? Yeah.
And it's great that they're very similar. It's like this plug and play of what you were getting at. Like, okay, here's our villain. Very cliche. Here's, it's got to be a revenge because someone in their family got killed by this guy.
Yep.
And they have to go find the mentor. And it's the same equation. And you would think you'd get bored with it. But it's just so, I don't know, so magical.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I don't know. I think what Adrian was saying a while ago, that equation never changes in real life.
Mm-hmm.
There's always some...
There's a reason why it's a cliche.
Yeah, there's always some negative force that needs to be dealt with. There's always, you know what I mean? There's always its impact on your personal life. And I think that's why probably these films are so relatable to a lot of people, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And the mental part of it too, right? Like you were talking about, I think, Caleb, you were talking about like just the training and the mental aspect of Kung Fu. And like that's, you know, I feel like when... we face problems, you know, we have to face them like mentally first before we physically do, you know what I mean? Like you have to like get to a point where like you're ready.
Just like the training in chess boxing, right? Like, no, seriously, like, cause he wouldn't let him fight until he had played chess for a month.
Yeah.
Like that's so crazy. Like another like mind blown moment.
Yeah.
Well, let's shift gears and kind of wind it down and move to the next part, which is recommendations on, if you, whether it's about Kung Fu movies or Wu-Tang Clan, a movie to watch next, music to check out, anything like that, who wants to start?
I'm going to start. I already said my recommendation, kind of. I like, spoiled it. But, like, Hip Hop Evolution on Netflix. If you don't have Netflix, steal somebody's password because this... in my opinion, as a person who didn't grow up inside of hip-hop culture, but, like... came into contact with the music later in life and fell in love with it.
Mm-hmm.
Like it completely shaped the whole story for me in a way that I don't think a lot of people feel in America. You know what I mean? The like actual visceral, real, gritty history of what went, the struggle that went into creating this music. And I think every person, whether you claim to like hip hop or not, to understand American history, you need to watch that series.
I would agree with that. Mm-hmm. Even as someone that I've loved hip hop my whole life, and someone that, you know, I probably have, you know, mistakenly like thought that I knew more than I did.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
Of course.
Just because like I kind of took it for granted because like I was always, you know, I always loved hip hop. So like that's what I thought. You know what I mean? So watching that, I was like, whoa, like this and this and this, you know, like you learn a lot. And there's just like so many, yeah, about history and about the music, but it's amazing. So I piggyback on you. But musically, I would say I love like you said, like Caleb said, early Wu-Tang. So like, you know, the 36 Chambers album is still like one of my favorite albums of all time. The Raekwon Cuban Lynx album. GZA had a Liquid Swords album. So like, you know, they branched off, right? And like everybody got to do like solo projects. And you know, Ghostface Killah's first album as well.
Oh man, that's
so like all the early Wu-Tang stuff I think was awesome. I would say like from 36 Chambers to Wu-Tang Forever, the double disc was a bit much for me, but like it didn't fulfill my expectations, you know, but hip hop was changing at that time too. So like there's a whole bunch going on, but I would say early Wu-Tang for sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Music wise, movies, I don't know. There's, That's
watch every movie associated with the Wu-Tang culture. Like, yeah. What is it? Shaolin versus Wu-Tang. What's the actual title of the 36 Chambers film? Is it
36 Chambers of Shaolin?
Yeah.
And then there's Return to the 36 Chambers.
I think 36 Chambers of Shaolin is the only one I've seen. I haven't seen Return to the 36 Chambers, but I would recommend that one too.
Mm-hmm. Caleb, what about you?
Yeah, musically, I came kind of backwards to Wu-Tang because I was a huge Ghostface Killah fan.
Yes.
I don't know why, other than I just picked up Iron Man from a UCD bin one day, and I was like, damn, this is so good.
The cover's legendary. It'll grab you, right?
Like, yeah, well, yeah. And I was always a huge, huge classic soul and funk fan, too. So, I mean, I feel like he uses the most out of anyone in the group on his solo stuff. He uses the most samples from that era. So yeah, Iron Man, Supreme Clientele, Fish Scale, any of his solo stuff, like, I am in love with.
He's just gonna read down the whole Ghostface Killah discography.
Honestly, there's not really. I mean, his Adrian Young produced albums from the mid 2010. I mean, those are amazing.
Did you see that show? I did not.
I didn't either. I just was happy for you if you did. So I kind of backtracked and got to Wu-Tang from Ghostface, but I'd recommend his solo stuff. There's a couple of good books at the Grand Rapids Public Library that I can recommend. Will Ashen's Chamber Music, Wu-Tang in America is a great study of the group. And
Adrian's writing this one down. Yeah.
And U-God's book, Raw, My Journey into the Wu-Tang, are both available.
U-God has a book?
Yeah. I think it just came out in the last couple of years, but
first
one of them to actually put out like a full look
he
at
was
it from the
always
inside.
Like the most, like, out of all of them, like, I was like, what does he do?
Well, he, from what I understand, he was an original member, but he wasn't able to contribute much to the first album, so I think he's kind of like the lost member in that
Okay,
way.
Yeah.
He was definitely there in 92.
Okay.
That's funny.
Yeah, it's hard to point somebody toward, like, hey, I want to get into kung fu movies.
Mm-hmm.
Where do I start? That'd be like somebody saying, yeah, I kind of want to get into sci-fi movies. It's like, well,
where do you begin?
From what era? From what country?
I think, like, for that kind of person, like, this is just me. Start with the Bruce Lee stuff because it's the legendary gold stuff, right? It's easily accessible and all that. I would say, like, any of those.
And I was gonna say, I mean, you know, if you have a hard time with some of the rickety elements of production, you can always look at Bruce because there's a reason he was a megastar.
Exactly.
He's super compelling. He's got such charisma.
Yeah.
You know, when he's on screen, like, you're always going to be entertained.
Yeah.
So any of his, I know that Fist of Fury is on Amazon Prime right now. It's kind of hard to find some of the other ones from the early 70s. I mean, YouTube is a great resource for a lot of these that you can't find anywhere else. Netflix has got a few. They've got Five Deadly Venoms, which I'd recommend. Something that I kind of got obsessed with in the last week or two was Five Elements Ninjas, which is both on Prime and Netflix.
Huh.
It's a really beautiful film. It's got a really clear, crisp transfer, so it's, you don't have to get through kind of that lo-fi look. But yeah, Five Elements Ninjas, even if you just want to skip to the last 10 minutes of it, you've never seen 10 minutes of fighting that looks like this.
Okay.
I mean, watch the whole thing for sure, but I really love that one. I always try to push Sonny Chiba and the Street Fighter trilogy, which you can watch all of on Prime, as well as the offshoot Sister Street Fighter.
Yeah.
Sonny Chiba's always a good time. I think that's about all I got.
What about...
You said Flying Guillotine earlier, right?
That's, I think, one you can catch on YouTube, too. Yeah.
It's a crazy movie.
I want to know, do you have... Sarah, do you have, like new... I'm thinking about, like, more, like, the more recent things that, like, recent kung fu.
Yeah, I don't know anything about,
like,
that.
I don't know. I kind of was just, like, it just dawned on me. Somebody mentioned Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon earlier.
Mm-hmm.
It was you.
Yeah.
And so then that got me thinking about, like, all these new Ip Man or...
There's a lot more of that
stuff, like,
on
so much
Netflix.
New
stuff.
Yeah.
Easier to find. any other like Jet Li and Donnie Yen, and
it'd be interesting to I kind of don't get into like when I think of kung fu movies that I want to watch
straight 70s,
I kinda
right?
Just like always right. Go back to yeah. I never think about the new stuff. Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon just made me sad. You know, it was great. It's a great movie, but like, you know, like
it's not one you're gonna like go in the backyard and start punching.
Yeah.
That's great.
Oh, so I gotta go. I gotta go tell my wife I love her.
Yeah. That's perfect.
Yeah. I loved it. I love Enter the Dragon still.
Yep.
When you were talking about Bruce Lee and going to Bruce Lee, because even I think even like right now, you know, right? Like there's. Because there's like these other characters, there's like this white kung fu like secret agent guy that he works with. There's like then there's the black dude, and then you know they have him like he runs in with the police. You know what I mean? Like it's just like this the parallels in the mirrors.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah. Like there's just some great. Yeah.
Yeah. Enter the Dragon is pretty much full on entertainment. The whole way through.
Yeah.
I'd recommend that for sure for somebody who's not sure how to dip their toe into.
Yeah. No, Fist of Fury, though, like, yeah. I remember I watched Fist of Fury after watching Enter the Dragon, and I had to, like, adjust my expectations for, like, what the movie would be. You know, yeah. It's dope, yeah.
Cool. I guess it's my turn, huh?
I guess
yeah. Give us your Rex.
Drum roll.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. No drum roll. So I already mentioned the book, The Tao of Wu by RZA, which I think is really fascinating because he talks about when in the 90s he got into kung fu training with a master. I think it was late 90s because I think the guy he was talking about came here from China around 92.
Okay.
So just understanding more of like the philosophical side of kung fu is really cool. For music, I feel like this might be a deep cut, but... there's this rapper, Pac FM. Adrian, I feel like I've told you about this song before. There's this one particular song called Nasty, which okay. When we're talking about Wu-Tang using their tongues like swords with the lyrics, I have not heard a song so sharp as that one, Nasty. Like he gets to this specific part that's just, how did you say it so fast? Oh my God.
Okay.
It's just
okay.
So, I don't know. Check it out. Pac FM Nasty.
You introduced me to that one. I was
did I?
Unaware.
Yeah, it's so good. Anyway, I think just like checking out hip hop and rap and having this new appreciation, being able to listen to it through a different lens, that's not right. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Having a new appreciation for it. As far as movies, there's a good amount of these 70s kung fu films on Canopy that you can check out. Again, it's free with your library card, so go for it. It's a great resource.
Awesome.
But also for fight sequences, when I see kung fu and like the great choreography, I always think of Old Boy, which I know that's a Korean film,
mm-hmm.
but that fight sequence, it's just like a 5 minute mm-hmm. sequence uncut that he's just going down the hall. Like
it's insane.
It's so amazing. Bad. Yeah. So you just have to appreciate what goes into making these films. And then my last thing, and then I swear I'll stop, is just going back to early American cinema and looking at folks like Charlie Chaplin and Buster Keaton and seeing them doing their stunts, but then comparing it to kung fu films. And I gotta say, like, I'm voting for kung fu because what we're talking about, these like gravity defying moves that they do,
yeah.
is just, it's beautiful. It takes so much talent and skill. And I don't know, just kind of comparing the two, I think is really interesting.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
So
I like that.
All right, cool. Well, thank you guys so much for humoring me with this conversation. Thank you for bringing your insight to the table. Tune in next time. Who knows what we're going to talk about, but now I need to go listen to some Wu-Tang Clan. So. All right, cool. Thanks, guys.
Yeah, thank you.